that there is this idea, this concept. Did you hear it there in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11? The pastors and the teachers, we are to equip the saints, all of you, for the work of ministry. Why should you hear that again? We as ministers and teachers are to equip the saints. That's you. Do you think of yourself as being a saint? Come on. Do you think of yourself as being a saint? Paul says that you are a saint. Every one of us who has followed Jesus Christ, we are called by St. Paul. We are called saints. And our job as ministers and teachers is to equip the saints for whatever it is that you do. The Greek word for equip is katartismon. Katartismon. Shocking word to be used in Scripture because it's actually a medical term in its original Greek. It means to bind up a broken bone. So what we are called to be as saints is that we are called to be to do these works of binding up, to put things in order. In other words, a setting that is used for mending this, he uses it sometimes as mending a broken fishnet. But the idea is to put something back in order so that it can be useful again. What we're talking about this morning is this theological idea that began in the Reformation and it was called the priesthood of all believers. Martin Luther and John Calvin, who were having so many difficulties with the ideas being taught in the Roman Catholic Church that you could only come to God through a priest. And they were saying, John Knox and Zwingli and all the rest of those, they were troubled by this concept that came out of Ephesians chapter 4. And as they read and studied Scripture and began to realize that the role of the pastor was to equip the body of Christ to do ministry. And so they came up with this idea, this concept of the priesthood of all believers. Now to us, we sort of yawn, sort of lean back, go, oh yeah, yeah, that's a nice idea. Don't know what it means, but it's fine. And that's priesthood of all believers. I want you to think about that with me for a moment. The word for priest comes from the Latin word pontifex. The Pope is sometimes called the pontiff. And from the original Latin, what that means is that we are called to be bridge builders, not wall builders. We are called to build bridges between ourselves and other people. All priests, all of us, remember priesthood of all believers, we are called to be bridge builders, not blockers, but bridge builders. Anyone in your neighborhood? Anyone in your family? Anyone in the church from whom you're estranged? You're a priest. You build bridges between yourself and that person. You become a conduit of God's love, God's grace. So if there's someone in your life that's been left out, should we say, if there's someone that we've excluded, if there's someone we've pushed to the margins of our life, you and I are called to be bridge builders to bring them back into our life. But the problem for us is that in our mind, in my mind, in your mind, there is this image of a priest or a minister or a saint. Because of that, we often fail to, because of that image, we often fail to claim our ministry. But there are only two qualifications to be one of those ministers, one of those priests, one of those saints. And that is this. The first is to have a personal and vital relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the first prerogative of being, that's the first thing to be up to being a priest or a saint or a minister. The other is availability, to be available by God, to be used to do this bridge building business. I'd like to introduce you this morning to Jean Price. She's probably a woman you'll never meet, but I want you to know her. Jean Price was one of those wonderful lay people that I had the privilege of serving when I was in Canyon Creek Presbyterian Church in Richardson, Texas, just outside Dallas. She was an elder, she'd been a deacon, she was involved. She was being used, if you will, by God and her church group. But what you need to know is Jean Price is a saint. She doesn't look like a saint. If she walked in here, you wouldn't see a halo hanging above her head. And at the time that I knew her, she was thinking about going to seminary, but she hadn't yet taken that step. But the point is, she was available to be used by God. I worked with her and another woman in Canyon Creek to develop a lay-centered ministry called Stephen's Ministers. And we worked very hard to put that together. We were training people and so forth. But she became the leader of the Stephen Ministry project. One Saturday afternoon, about an hour before I was to go into the sanctuary and conduct a wedding, I got a call from one of the dear members of our church. She said that her next door neighbor had a daughter who was 16 years old who on Friday night had attempted to commit suicide. She had been taken to the hospital and they revived her, and she was now being brought home later that afternoon, and she really needed to talk to someone. Would I be available? She was in rough shape. She had been put in touch with a psychiatrist for Monday morning, but there was no one to talk to through the weekend, and she was ready to talk. The neighbor, the woman from our church, said, "Oh, you need to meet Jack Noble. He'd be more than helpful to you. You really need to meet him." And I told her, I said, "I would really love to do it, but I'm getting ready to go into a wedding, and I'm not going to be available for several hours, so have you ever wanted to be in two places at one time?" Well, that was the way I was. So I thought about it for a moment, and I said, "Why don't you bring her on over?" And I started calling. We had three or four ministers on the staff at that point, and I started to call around, and no one was available. Then the idea hit me that I should call Jean Price. I explained to Jean that I was in an absolute jam and I needed some help. I told her the situation. She said, "Jack, this is a little out of my league." And I said, "Jean, here, this is out of my league too. But we really need to have someone here to talk to this girl. She's going to be coming over in a few minutes." Well, Jean Price, and Jean Price came. When the girl arrived, her first question was, Jean was going to meet her, then, "What is Jack Noble like? I mean, does he wear a black robe and a collar and all that stuff?" And she said, "Oh, no, he's a regular guy." Well, about 20 minutes before the wedding, it was time for me to get dressed, and the girl arrived, and I went down where Jean was and the young girl, and sure enough, I walked in with a black robe and a collar. Let me introduce you to Jack Noble. Well, the girl's face fell. Because she, sure enough, there I was with a black robe and a collar, the whole show. I went ahead with them for the briefest of minutes, and then the girl and Jean Price and myself. You see, what I didn't tell you was I caught Jean Price on her way to go out on Saturday afternoon and run some errands. And because of the situation, she didn't have time to change clothes. And so she came in a Mickey Mouse t-shirt. And when the girl saw that, her eyes lit up and she said, "Disney World is my favorite place in the whole world." I interrupted. Seeing that I was just on the way, I excused myself and we had this wonderful conversation. Did the wedding, did the pictures, all those things that go through with that. And I went back and I found where they were and I looked in the office and they were having this wonderful conversation which went on for 3 hours. That day, a Canyon Creek Presbyterian Church, for the first time expecting to see a minister, this girl didn't expect to find a woman in a Mickey Mouse t-shirt. But the minister that day was not the guy in the collar and the black robe. In fact, the collar and that black robe was a roadblock for that young girl. It would have stopped everything, I fear. That girl, that day, saw the face of Jesus in a woman with a Mickey Mouse t-shirt on. I couldn't do it. And today, that girl is a wonderful woman. Her life has been put back together. And God did that through a woman in a Mickey Mouse t-shirt named Jean Price. And that very same thing could happen to you. I can see some of you saying to yourself, "Well, you know, Jack, I don't have any training. I could never do that. I don't have any education. I'm not enough. There's no way that I could." But I'll tell you this. In strengthening our connection with Jesus Christ, and making sure we are available to be used by God, if those two things are in place, God will use us. Because you see, you go to places that I will never go to. You talk to people that I will never talk to. You are in situations that no one else in this church will ever be in. God may be calling you to be the woman in the Mickey Mouse t-shirt. Maybe it's just your ministry of prayer, and I don't mean to minimize that. Maybe it is your ministry of prayer. Maybe it is giving a bottle of cold water to one of those people standing by the roadside trying to get money. Maybe it's your ministry with Alcoholics Anonymous. Maybe it's something in your family that's gone wrong and God calls you to help make it right. Maybe there's someone in your neighborhood. I don't know, because the situations you are in are very, very different from the situations I'm in. Several years ago now, a girl in the sixth grade class, along with the rest of her class, was on a field trip to see a silversmith do his work. And they had toured his shop, and then they went back to where he was working, and he explained to them that when he was using silver in order to make it sterling, he had to put it in a furnace and melt away all the impurities. And he had them look through a boring hole where they could see. And everyone gathered around. And this little girl in the sixth grade asked him how he knew that the silver was finished. And he said, "I know it's finished when I can see the reflection of my face." You know, God knows when we're ready. When God and someone else looks into our eyes and can see the face of Jesus. There are people in your life who are starving, literally starving, to see the face of Jesus. To see the face of Jesus in your face. And would it surprise you to know this morning that there are some saints in this church sitting right next to you? Well, they may not have a halo. They may not be dressed in beautiful robes. They may not look any different from you, but they are saints. Maybe they're dressed in a jacket. Maybe they have on a beautiful dress. Maybe they're even wearing high heels. Or maybe they're just wearing a Mickey Mouse t-shirt. You'll never know them by their clothes. But you'll know them because you can see the face of Jesus in their face.
Thank you. We are called to be God's people.
You're speaking.
We are called.